said every day.
Okay.
Now,
yes.
Oh, hey! I didn't bring a song. How do you get it?
Bright and fair, I feel
I'm going to go. y'all doing? Good?
Hello, hello, hello.
Hey, let me give you about 14 announcements. Y'all got ready? Well, about 12 of them are related to Vacation Bible School this week. So let's see if we can get these together. And I hope I can remember them all. Okay, don't forget, you can pick up one of these in your Sunday school class, which is at 10. Justin? Or is that Justin's brother that I have not met? What happened to you, buddy? Did you lose? Justin, what happened? You lost your... Did the kids do that to you when you were sleeping? Huh? He shaved his beard. He sure did. And his mustache. I don't even know who that is. Hey, good to see you, Justin. All the focus on you, sorry. Hey, let me remind you about some stuff, though. Vacation Bible School starts tonight. Y'all know that? We're so excited. We've been looking forward. They've been getting everything decorated in the fellowship hall around the building. And so we can always use help. Just see Rhonda, Star, let them know of your availability. So if you can be here on one day, adults, and if you want to help with something like a one day thing, let them know, and we'd appreciate that. There's always help that's needed. Sometimes our adults are getting late from work, and so they have to fill in a gap, that kind of thing. So Vacation Bible School, there's a registration form that's in the fellowship hall on the table when you first go in. So if you've not registered your children for VBS, be sure to do that for us. That will help speed the process tonight. 5:45 is when it starts, and it's over at 8:30, and we're pretty good with that. We have a little meal. We have, let me see, another announcement.
Just that we have a nursery only for the workers.
Okay, and the nursery is from 3 and under, I think, something like that? 3 and under. Under 3, okay. And then the rest of them, they can come join us. So Vacation Bible School, it's always a lot of fun. We appreciate that. We're finished up on Thursday night. So that's our kind of our family night. And then next, there's a lot more to VBS than that, but if you have any questions, if you find yourself available on one of those nights, let Rhonda or myself know. We'll get you hooked up with some things. There's just things that happen that aren't even planned for. You know, there's always a spill when we're eating. There's just stuff like that. So it's not high tech on it. Yes, Brother Billy.
Just for the men's information, we will still be having men's Bible study on Wednesday night at 6:30.
Okay. So men's class, I don't know if we got that on there. Men's class will still be able to meet over. And I told Billy and some of the guys last week, I said, y'all, as far as I know, y'all can still meet over there. We may need you every now and then, may come ask for some help, but just meet over there. And it's relatively quiet there. Now, there may be a ball goes through the window. I don't know from the outside, but just throw it back out. Okay, if it comes through, just you'll take care. Okay, good deal. All right. Next Sunday is Father's Day, and so we'll have our Father's Day men's and boys. And really, it turned out for the women, it's just everybody's eating. We just had a kind of a breakfast. We're going to honor the dads and also just let the men and the boys have a kind of a little program there too as well. So the breakfast part of it, ladies, y'all are cooking. Remember, the guys cooked. We cooked for y'all. We did an outstanding job. The women, they just love the food. So we will love your food that you're cooking. But you need to see Teresa. She's down a couple of her normal cooks that help us are gone. Like Kelly's gone to somewhere. I don't know where she's at right now. Do we even know? We should have like a little map showing where they're going on their way to Alaska. So we don't know where they're at. No one's heard from them.
They're in Alberta.
They're already in Canada. Man, they've been booking it. Okay, so they're working. Thank you so much. Do you have them, did you put an Apple AirTag?
Facebook this morning.
Okay. If they're, Rusty and Kelly, we miss you if you're watching us. Oh, Jennifer. I told you we'd pray for Jennifer. She's in the hospital. And she's going to be in there for a couple more till Wednesday. So she's really missing out being here. So we want to pray for Jennifer Malone. We'll be doing that later. But Jennifer, if you're watching us, we miss you and look forward to you getting home soon. See Teresa. Cooks, you'll need to be there at 7:30. That's next Sunday. We're going to have a meal, by the way, during VBS, so that's good. Thanks, Glenn. Do you need some extra help with that? Okay, so if you want to help, Glenn, you're going to be getting here before 5. You'll probably start before 5:45 to cook for the meal. So what time would they?
Probably 4:30.
Okay. So if you want to help Glenn stir stuff or cook stuff, be here about 4:30. That'd be helpful. Is that tonight? Do we have a meal tonight? We have a meal tonight, too. Sweet. All right. You know, hold on for just a second. What do we have tonight? Nachos? So if I was going to the Mexican restaurant for lunch, don't order nachos. We're having nachos tonight. Okay. You got some jalapenos? Okay. All right. Y'all ready? Does that sound good? Are y'all getting hungry? I'm starting to get a little bit hungry. All right. I've got that one done. I got that one done. And we got some other stuff coming up in the near future. Y'all can look at that. Someone else gave me an announcement. I'm sure there's probably another announcement or two I forgot. Hey, let me introduce to y'all. Last week we had our belonging class. Belonging class is what we is a way that people that have been visiting our church, attending, wanting to connect, learn more about church. We have a class that we kind of lead through, kind of answer some questions, more of a smaller setting. And as a result of going through that, they discover things like, what do we believe about salvation? You know, what does it mean to be saved, baptized, Lord's Supper, what our church does, how we're organized, how we give, and how that money goes to different places. So a lot of different things that we walk through in some of our basic or core beliefs as a Southern Baptist church. And so last week we had several that went through the class with us. Raylan Perry, she was actually baptized and saved last year, but I wanted her to come through this class so she could kind of catch up. So she went through with us. She's already was saved, was baptized here, part of our church. But also attending John and Joanne McMillan, they've been coming to Sunday school and worshiping and helping us already in different ways. And so they went through the class and they are connecting with our church. And they're going to join by letter from Southside Baptist Church in Carthage, Texas. So John and Joanne, we're glad you're here and look excited for y'all. Thank you. All of these people that I mentioned here, we walked through salvation and they've expressed that they are saved, they've been baptized, and so then walking through the rest of the class as well. Jason and Sandy Cosby, Jason Cosby and his mom Sandy, they couldn't make it in because their truck is broke down. They're coming from up on the mountain, so they have to take that truck to get down to where we're picking up now is out of Panola fire station, and that's a 45-minute drive by truck. And for some reason, they didn't want to go walk 8 miles. I don't know what time you have to start from where they live to get here and then 8 mile back. So they're not able to be here, but they are also coming. They're coming by baptism, and they'll be baptized out at the Bobbers Cave Park in August when we do our baptisms out there. So that's Jason and Sandy Cosby. Y'all know they've been with us. And then in addition, Rachel and Becky Allen, Rachel and Becky went through the class, Rachel's husband couldn't be here. He's on the road, so he couldn't be here. He'll try to work this next time he can be in town. But they're coming. They also know Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, have been baptized, and they're coming by statement of faith to be a part of our church as well. And so we're excited for Rachel and Becky as well. John and Joanne. God bless you. We're excited for the work, and a lot of these have already been attending and working and serving, and so thank you so much. We always are praying for God to raise up workers and to raise up followers of Jesus Christ, and so we'll learn more about it. So that's a lot of stuff for you. Glad to see you. Hey, this pastor, Nicole, we're praying for you. Your baby's going to be here this week. And so Nicole and Mark and Tisha and Adam came and brought a bunch of stuff out there last Wednesday. Y'all saw that Wednesday with the kids having a good time. And so we appreciate y'all bringing that last week for them to enjoy as our, part of our VBS recruitment, I guess, and enhancement. And so we'll be praying for you. You're going in Wednesday. So we'll be praying for the safe delivery, and we'll look forward to seeing your baby. You said you're going to be here next week. That's pushing it. Yes, my daughter says that's pushing it. So when you can be here, we'll be looking forward to seeing your family as well. All right, now we're ready to worship. Y'all ready? Hey, why don't y'all stand up? Y'all ready to stand anyway? The group's coming their way.
Are y'all ready?
Yes.
We got to, sometimes we're having a little, we got Philip up here, Jennifer's gone, so
God's
got it all back there. Back. We appreciate God. We just need, yeah, go maestro.
Yeah.
some offerings. Ushers, please. All right, Delvin, good to have you back from off the road. Would you mind praying to the Father offering, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we can gather in your house to feel the love and spread the joy. As we gather today to praise the Lord that we're not able to be here, but as we gather, so we show love, courteous, and gather to take this offering and spread from the need of our church and all the things that we see. Lord, just bless it and thank you for everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Be set free.
As you sent Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we have a chance, Lord, just to come into your presence. And only through Jesus Christ that we can do this. And thank you, Lord, that you prepared a way for us to have a relationship with you. I pray that you'll be our pastor. He stands for us. He brings your word. I pray, God, that if somebody's here that does not have that relationship with you, I pray, God, that today they'll make that decision, Lord, and be forever changed. Thank you, Lord, that you love us. Be with us through the rest of the service today. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Have a moment to pause and pray for some of those I mentioned earlier. We'll pray for Jennifer Malone and y'all can come up here and pray around Gracie for her mom in just a minute. What's that? Yes. And then also I mentioned Nicole's going to have her baby this week, so some of y'all may want to go and pray over Nicole and pray for. We pray for Connor and for her sister Dolly. Dolly's in the hospital. Connor, there was one day I was sitting there going, man, Connor, you took your husband to the doctor and found out some stuff about him that we want to pray for. And I think that same day, then you took Jennifer over to the hospital. And then if I'm not off, it seemed like it was just then within hours the next morning you were taking Dolly. So and then we were running yesterday. That's why all these little green shirts are on. These are all these people that ran at how's it pronounced, Lucy? Turtle. The turtle race down. That's appropriate. That's about how fast I run. So we ran that down at the Choctaw grounds yesterday. And so she got a little bit low blood pressure. With all that she's going on, she should have had high blood pressure, I think. But so if y'all want to come and pray with Connor, pray over Connor, for Randy, for Dolly, and for all that. So there's a couple people pray up here. Delton, you want some back there too? We'll give you some love.
I just want to say that as we pray for my life, I can really appreciate the church family and really love Connor. For what she's done, I was not in a place that I could do anything but hurry up and get home.
Right.
And I do appreciate what she did for my life.
Stepped in. Thanks. Thanks, Connor. Really good sister in Christ. All right, so there's some prayers. I know there may be a couple others that you have. I would like for someone to pray over you. So is anybody else in the room? Of course, we're talking about praying for BBS and all that, teachers and stuff. Okay. Pray for her. I was giving a report to Jennifer Woods. She's our the district elder on the Choctaw Nation tribal stuff for our area, District 6. And so I told her that we were going out and do the hamburger thing last Saturday. So I kind of gave a report. I wanted to see if we got in trouble, you know. And I said, no, thank you to the church for all the hamburgers given out there to the Choctaw, the new housing area out there. a week ago Saturday. She said she heard everything was great. She said the only bad thing was now that they are saying, how come the Choctaws haven't brought us hamburgers where we live? And so Jennifer said, I'm kind of like embarrassed, you know. I said, Jennifer, you do so much for people around here. It's just amazing. So she said, thanks. So I want to share that with you. Thanks, church, and for the group that did it, for the work in your heart to serve that part. And as I was visiting with her, we've got to engage with the chief and talk to him. And so he just asked for us to pray for their leadership and for him. Because in the day and age that they live in, as a leader for the Choctaw Nation, they're dealing with woke and culture as well. How does that work in this community and their tribal traditions? And it's just a lot on his heart. So pray for Chief Gary Batten, and pray for him. He's an active member at First Baptist Church in Clayton. And we were talking, Paul, I was over there talking, and we were just swapping stories about dealing with boys on Wednesday nights. And I thought we were the only ones, and he just said, no, we've got this. In Clayton, we have, and so we just shared some stories, and we didn't talk too much about personnel, just said, so there's a lot of things. So he loves worshiping the Lord, and he's a member at First Baptist Church in Clayton. And so he covets your prayers, whether you're tribal or not. I think we pray for our country, and we live within this boundary. So I think that's something that sometimes I forget to remind us to pray for that element of the nation that we live within here in Wilberton in Latimer County. So I bring in his name up to you as well, as Jennifer Woods, who's very active, and she's helped us a lot in this community. So let's pause and pray for these things, okay? And if you want to get up and pray for some of those I mentioned, please go there right now. Take time to pray for them, and I'll close this in a prayer after a moment or so. Thank y'all. Y'all go ahead and start praying for them. Father, as we're praying right now for some of our church members, Fathers, each one is just asking for your presence, Father, in the struggles and the things of life that they're facing. And some, it seems like it's just an overwhelming, how am I going to make it through this day or this week, or Father, even beyond that. So Lord, we ask that you will give them wisdom, give them help, surround them with brothers and sisters in Christ to step in as needed and to help, Lord. Father, we think of right now, I'm just thinking of Jennifer Malone right now. We pray for her healing, and she's probably, knowing her, she's probably listening in. So Jennifer, we love you, and we're praying for you right now. We pray that you'll be able to get through these next 2 days, continue healing, Father, as needed, so she can go home safely and be back with her family. She wishes she could be here, especially this week. It's on her heart. She loves this time of the year. So bless her and her family. Father, we pray for Nicole as she's ready to have this baby. Lord, we ask that you'll give them safety and watch over her and Mark and her friends that are here as well. Bless them, Father, for their time. And Lord, I pray now that as we're thinking about all these, then beyond, Father, there's some that we think about, the chief of the Choctaw Nation, Lord, the burden that he faces right now, and the how to deal with that. Lord, I just pray that you will give him courage and surround him with others to step in and help him in these decisions they're having to make. And Lord, for us, that we will be godly and bold in what you called us to speak about your truth. Father, each of us standing together in and upon the word that you've given us. Father, give us compassion. Give us that mercy and grace we've been singing about, so we may bring this to a lost world, a world right here where we're living, to the boys and girls and their families that are coming tonight, that we may love them from the very moment they walk, Father, get on the van, if it's that, or get in their cars to come here, from the moment they walk in the building when they're eating, Father, together in the fellowship hall, the crafts and the Bible stories and the recreation and the singing, and the loving and the caring, Lord, may it be your presence through us in such a way that these boys and girls will know that you love them without a doubt, and not just for this moment, for their lifetime. And Father, for all the grown-up boys and girls that are across this area that were in a vacation Bible school in years past, Father, I pray that when they're facing situations where they don't know what to do, they've lost their way, they've lost their what's really the truth, and Father, I pray that you will remind them, Father, where they hear vacation Bible school, whether it be here or across out in the country at Bowers, that they that these adults will know that you love them. Bring back into their mind those moments where those words that are so dear to us from your scripture will just be flooded back into their memories, and they'll be drawn to you. Lord, I thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you all for praying. And may this be a moment in the hearts of all to remind ourselves that we can do this, not just as an exercise and a practice of worship, but that we can do that in the streets, on the road, someone that we don't know to someone we know dear. You can do this at Roy's on any of the aisles. I've not had Joe come up to me when I prayed for someone. He hasn't come and said, Brother Paul, you can't do this in my store. Joe won't do it. I think I've done it in some of the gas pumps around town, and I haven't had any of them. Now, it always is helpful when I'm putting in about $50 worth of gas in the church van that they don't say anything to me because they're doing this. So we don't want to distract from business, but we don't want to distract from, we don't want to neglect from his business either. So his business is a priority over any of the other business that we're dealing with. So we need to remember this. You practice in here, you worship in here, and you take it out and you keep doing it out there too. So look with me in Romans chapter 5. We're going to finish up chapter 5 today. Next Sunday we'll be in chapter 6, and the following Sunday in chapter 6. We're doing about 2 Sundays per chapter. I wish I would have the time, but as I mentioned, that we could go on for 5 or 6 years in just the book of Romans. So those spots that you are reading along with me and you say, but I need to know more about that. There's a part in here where there's a great big discussion. This is a critical part to understand the book of Romans, this chapter, and in particular this set of passages. So we cannot cover it all. You will need to study this further as you think about what's being laid out for you. I will try to do my very best to just boil it down to three things for you. We are in ruins. Humanity is in ruins. Okay, so we're going to see that in this passage. But we know that God, who is the creator of humanity, he created this universe, the creator of all that we have, he is our creator. He is also the one that will be the one that brings us redemption. So we'll see this in this passage. And then we'll also see, we'll hear the word rain in this scripture. We sang about it. So I heard in this one song about rains, that our his grace reigns, as in rules. But then there's this idea, Lord, let your mercy rain down. I love them. I think we can misunderstand, but yet understand that idea of raining down from heaven is also because he is raining over us with grace. So let's don't forget about saying the word reign, R-E-I-G-N, as in rule. So there's three things we're looking at today. Three things. And try to put everything underneath one of those, if you can. And that will help. Not get too complicated, but not miss the depth of this. We're going to be on the surface of a very deep, beautiful lake. Okay? And understanding of God's wisdom here for us. So, if you found Romans chapter 5, picking up at verse 12, let me just talk about, first of all, the ruins because of sin. Verse 12 says this, "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man," can you give me that name?
Adam.
Okay. "And death," wait, I guess we could all say ourselves, but that would be a misinterpretation of this passage. We are talking about Adam. Talking about Adam, the first man. They represent the head of all humanity. So when we think about that, us, we think of Adam. So there it says, "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, in this way, death spread to all men because all sinned." So all of us have sinned. We know that we could look all the way back. There's not been an exception to that, with the exception of the second Adam, which we know is Jesus. So through all of humanity, how many have sinned except for Jesus Christ? All. So if we want to put a big ledger up here, and we put up over here all the sinners that have ever lived, okay? And then we have this other, on this other side over here, we'd have the one that was sinless, okay? That would be Jesus, okay? So Jesus over here, and where are we all? I realize you're in Christ, so you're saved, so you'd say you're here, but just for the sake of right at this moment, there is a point in time in all of our lives before we came to know Christ and we're adopted, that we were all over here. Everybody. Now that's kind of hard for me, because that means my little granddaughter, where, did she leave us?
She's talking.
My wife and my granddaughter left us. So even little baby, every human being is in this spot. All of us. Now, I'm not trying to answer the issue, what happens when a baby dies? And, you know, is that child covered by, oh, she is talking. She's, hey, just for a second, y'all hear her? That's her language for pawpaw. That is. No one else has heard this, but I know her language. So, it's kind of distracting to me, because I hear her calling my name, and I have to stop. That's why she has to leave. Okay, so when we see this verse, it says here, in fact, sin was, in verse 13, in fact, sin was in the world before the law. Okay? So the law was given to Moses. Okay? So we remember that. So before Moses, before God gave Moses the law to the people of Israel, so that we have the law to the Ten Commandments and all that, then he says, in fact, sin is the world before the law, but sin is not charged to a person's account when there is no law. That sounds like, if you're not careful here, that then there was no sin. Paul is not dealing with the issue of the law here. He's dealing with the issue of humanity's sin and how it separates us from God. Nevertheless, verse 14, death reigned. Now, hear that word reigned, rule. Death reigned from Adam, first man, first created in the image of God, to Moses, where God gave the law, even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam's transgression. Adam's transgression was he disobeyed the law in the garden that he gave to him to not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Remember that? That was a law, a command. He is a prototype of the coming one, talking about Jesus, who's the second Adam. So, in the first part, there is this visual that all of us are under, if you would, the headship or the first or Adam. All of us would go back. If you're into genealogy, you know, and you're searching out where you came from and your roots, and you've even maybe taken some of these DNA tests, and you've found out that you're 2% from here and 1% from here and 3% from there, and you're all over the place, you know, and you do all that stuff. Just remember this. If you're going to believe, if you believe in God's word, every one of us trace ourselves back to Adam. And in some ways, we can also trace ourselves back to Noah, because everybody was wiped out. But all of us would trace our roots, our human DNA, our who we are as a created in the image of God. And so we all look back to Adam, and he sinned. And ever since that first sin, in essence, it was rebellion against God. In essence, it was, I want to be like God. And so it transgressed. He wanted to take over. He wanted to put himself on the throne of his own kingdom. And we've all been doing it ever since. We all have a self-centered selfishness at the root of who we are. Sometimes we call it self-preservation. We want to preserve who we are, our legacy, those kinds of things. But we still have that in our nature. We have a sin nature. We know that. We have that. We could say we owe it. We could blame Adam. But you know what? If you want to say, I'm going to blame Adam, and so I'm not going to buy that, Pastor, that's what God's word teaches, but there's where it starts. If you had been in Adam's place, you would have done the same thing, because you're going to rebel against God. We all will. We all will. Every one of us. If you haven't come to that place where you understand that, then this is the spot where it needs to be an aha moment. You can't buy into needing to trust in Jesus and who he is without understanding how lost you are. That's why it's not just enough to know about what Jesus did, but to know who you are and what condition you're in. All humans are in this same boat. They're all on the same ledger. They're all under the same condemnation of sin. And so we know that. We were in ruins, in other words. These couple of verses here from 12, 13, and 14 talks about the ruin, about the devastation, about how we are all in the same spot. We are lost. Verse 15. Now we'll talk about the rescue. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if by the one man's trespass the many died, how much more have the grace of God and the gift overflow to the many by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ? So we got the one man that leads to death, Adam. Now we have the one man, the second Adam, if you would, and other scriptures talks about the one man, Jesus Christ. And the gift is not like the one man's sin, because from one sin came the judgment, resulting in condemnation, verse 16. But from many trespasses came the gift, resulting in justification. Since by the one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive the overflow of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? You know, if Disney was making a movie out of it, a weird kind of movie, they would have something about this, with this one man, how it's polluted and everything else. And their idea of salvation would be someone to come to the rescue, and all that would happen from the rescue by whoever it is that they designate as a great rescuer, the great prince or whatever it may be in that particular movie, they would just have some way of coming over here and touching us all, somehow giving us something that would then help us to all be restored into the Garden of Eden. That's what Paul's trying to get across. This work of Jesus is not to restore us or to get us away from this sin and the results of it and then give us eternal life living in the garden. That's why he's saying much more. One man, one sin, one act of rebellion polluted all of us. The man, completely man, completely God, Jesus Christ, came to us. And not just to restore us to life or to a relationship in the garden, but to enable us much more, an overflow. Remember last week, in the early part of this chapter, we discovered that there was a whole slew of things, an access to God, peace with God, rejoicing both in the good, the glory of God, as well as in times of affliction. And oh, that's so cool. Right across from my office, Lisa or whoever was it, bought that little, some of the decor on the wall. I was going by, and I was sitting there after church was over. I was walking back, putting my Bible up, and I'm sitting there, and here's this one plaque, and it says, "And patience in affliction." You'll have to see it when you go down to your classes sometime. I just thought that. So much more does God do through Jesus Christ. He didn't send his son to simply restore us to pre-Adam sin. He brought us not just forgiveness, but a gift, not just mercy, not just grace. He has brought us so much. That's why that word, much more. We can't really fathom all the much more that's in there. It's almost a daily experience where you open up and you see so much more of what God has done in your life and your relationships with other people and your relationship, of course, with Him. When you're exploring and studying God's Word, you'll discover more and more. Not just opening up a treasure box, but it's like that where when you open up, you don't just look at the pile of jewels, but you begin to take them out and begin to try them on. You're going to try on and see things as God puts them into your heart and into your life in such a way that you're going like, man, my life was in ruins. And so we know humanity is in ruins. My life, your life was in ruins. But when you put your faith, your trust, receive the gift of what God's done, your life is going to be not just rescued, not just restored, but it's going to be redeemed and given so much more than you ever expected when you said yes to Jesus Christ. And he says, and the gift, verse 16, is not like the one man sin, because from one sin came judgment, resulting in condemnation. But from many trespasses came the gift, resulting in justification before God. God welcomes you. He says, you have been forgiven. And he says, since by the one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive the overflow of the grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. So then, let's discover this reign. As though one trespass, there is condemnation for everyone, so also through one righteous act, there is life-giving justification for everyone. For just as through one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so also through the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. Amen. The law came along to multiply the trespass. Here's the law coming in. The law just points out all the ways that you've sinned and rebelled against God. The law was given not to save you. The law was given to show you how lost and how rebellious and how much you needed someone to rescue you. The purpose of the law was not for salvation, but to bring us to God for redemption. And Paul is saying then, but where sin multiplied, grace multiplied even more, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace will reign through righteousness, resulting in eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. So, the ledger. before God, all of us are written in and we are lost. We are sinners. We have no hope, no way out, except for being on His team, His family, trusting in Him. So the question is, who are you following? And you may not say you're following Adam, but you may say, well, I'm following this guy. And throughout human history, there have been groups of leaders and everything else that Satan puts in place through his work. And so people have followed after in the human perspective, in the human way of looking at things. And that's the struggle that we're living in today as believers. That we need to get off of this page, get out of following these people, and make sure that in everything that we do and everything that we think that is in line with the Word of God, and we are following after our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the one that brings us justification. He is the one that makes us righteous because of His one righteous act, one sinful act, condemned and brought it all to us, and we would have done the same thing. But Jesus Christ came to be obedient to the Father and to come to give His life for you and me, to pay for our sins, to cover us in such a way that the mercy does rain down upon our souls and rain down upon our heart and rain down in our mind to cleanse us from all those things, and to not just to restore us, but to transform us into a child of God. And we are called to follow Jesus Christ. And we are to be in His path and His way of living in the midst of a very difficult time of human history, maybe worse than ever. And I know there's been some bad times, but we know we're getting closer and closer. And the closer we get to the return of Christ, the closer we get to the end of human history and time, we know it gets worse and worse in human history. So there's a time for us to fight against the culture, but the main fight we have is the Word of God, who Jesus Christ is, the gospel of Christ, and that's what we are to declare, to stand upon the Word of God. Here's His truth. Here's what we are called to do. And the chief said, I know what I believe, but I'm being accused of hateful. I said, I know. It's hard. He said, you be the God representative. You need to be in your position. And I'll do the same. He said, we're praying for you. But the biggest group that can help support the leaders in our country are believers like you and me, taking our stand, not just voting, but taking our stand on the truth of God and not wavering. I looked at him and said, Chief, I can look at you all day long and say, I believe that I am full-blood Choctaw and I'm entitled to all the benefits. You tell me what? No, not because of the way I look, because you're not on certain things. I'm telling you, folks, the only way you're going to get into heaven, not because of your works, right, because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Yes. It's because Jesus put your name in because of your putting your faith in Jesus Christ. And we must depend upon the Word of God as our authority and in what we believe. And when the culture says you can't believe that, then the culture is out of step and the culture is over here on this side of the page. We must stand clearly and boldly upon the Word of God, teaching the Word of God, living the Word of God with our families, with our friends, with our school systems, with our education, with the governments. We must stand upon the Word of God. We must realize that we're in a new relationship and we are following Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. Amen. And so where are you today? Are you still stuck over here? Have you never given your life to Jesus Christ? It's a gift. Not your works. It's a gift. He's calling you to Him. If you've not given your life to Jesus Christ, come right now. If you're a Christian, there's no middle ground. You're either over here hanging out with sinners and believing what they teach, or you're over here with the Word of God, with Jesus Christ, and calling out to sinners to come to Jesus, to come to Jesus. I know there's that spot where you're right here. It's kind of a visual breakdown here in this picture, but we have to call the sinners to Jesus. We've got to reach out and love them and bring them to Jesus. And that's why we are here this morning, to remind ourselves of what God's calling us to do. So where are you, believers? What is God asking you to do for Jesus Christ? Let's pray. Father, as we come right now, we thank you for all that you've given us. Lord, as we come into this moment of decision, we ask, Father, as you're speaking to our hearts, if there's someone that needs Jesus, they know they're lost, they know there's no hope for them, and they know the only way they can be saved is through Jesus Christ. There is no other Savior, only Jesus. Father, I pray that they know that without Jesus, they're lost. And because they're lost, they don't want to stay there. Father, I pray that you'll draw them to you right now. And Father, for our believers, give them boldness and courage and Father, the ability to use your word. Let your word flow through them in the conversations they have as they declare the truth of your word about family. Father, the truth of your word about who they are individually, and Father, most importantly, who they are in relationship to you through Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. It's in His name we pray. Amen. The Lord's calling you right now. You come right now as we stand to sing and praise the Lord in this song of invitation. You come to Jesus. Come right now. Come right now.
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let Him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to time after time? He has waited before, and now He is waiting again to see if you're willing to open the door. Oh, how He wants to. Keep you apart. Why?
Sometimes when we're in this moment of decision, there's something else that God puts in your mind or your heart about someone. And so you use that moment to pray. And sometimes God says, I want you to go talk to that person, to love him. And so that's one of the things that we just always cherish. That invitation happens here for a little bit of time, but it also is open beyond this. So if God's speaking, your next step in a decision is very important. It's part of your faith. So I encourage you, if God's laying in your heart something, see someone. You know, if it's something that you're afraid to walk down front because you're not sure what's going on. Y'all have seen, I'm sorry. If someone sometimes comes in this building, they're like, what's going on down front? You know, is that what's going on? So if you're in that spot, but you know God's speaking to you, then just see me or Teresa or my wife who's up here, or one of the people that brought you here, invite you. They'll be glad to help you and pray with you about what God's working your life for. So may God bless you. And Miss Bobby wants to share with us. Can I turn on the pink one? Let's see. The pink one, Brother Scott.
The Lord has been dealing with me about some sins, and it's I want you, if you're a Christian, remember that there's people watching you, and I've had people watch me and say good things, but in my heart I know that God is He sent Jesus down here for a reason, and we know that because we have accepted him as our Lord. But we need to also understand that we as Christians are accountable for some things. And I have felt that. I felt that maybe I have not lived up to, you know, Jesus is over here and the world is over here. How much do we actually let the world in? We let the world in a lot. And so and that's what I'm saying. I wanted to say to Christians that, you know, Jesus, have y'all remember the words that, what would Jesus do? You know, I still ask myself that about certain things. That what would Jesus do? Would he be happy with us, you know? But let's not forget that our Christianity does affect other people, whether it's good or whether it's bad. So we need to just be what we are, but follow Christ. I think that message he gave us today was so good. It was really good and it touched me.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Bobby. Y'all affirm her. Y'all want to affirm her. All right. So, So you all have a great afternoon. We'll see you back around 4:30 or so. Let's close in the moment of prayer, and then we leave. If there is anything that we can help you with further, just see us on the way out, all right? Hey, as we close in prayer, Brother Justin, would you close us?
Salt and light, so that there is a greater way and there is truth. I pray for the